We don't really grasp what is happening when these forces overtake someone. It could be similar to that of peak experiences for the sublime. Every artist has experienced that spark of inspiration amidst the company of profound boredom. Those moments when you're banging your head against the wall for hours and finally something clicked. And after hours of bargaining with yourself and procrastinating, and you finally felt that zap that drove you to create some of your best work. One can immediately picture this experience. You know, this is the mode of being we're all striving towards. This feeling has been described as many things throughout history. It is best known as the muse. This comes from the Greek word musai. This refers to the nine daughters of Zeus and Mnemosyne, the goddess of memory. These nine goddesses presided over the arts and sciences, each of them controlling a different aspect, listed here. The term muse, referring to these goddesses, has been adopted to refer to any bodiless or embodied mysterious force that drives one to create and gives one inspiration. Even the narrator in the beginning of Homer's Odyssey asks the muse for inspiration. You can imagine any number of genius artists being hit with that eureka moment that led them to create some of their masterworks. And many artists describe this mysterious force as something that overtakes them. I'm going to let old Joseph James Rogan explain it for me.
Everybody that I know that creates things has a very similar narrative. They're like, it's coming out of nowhere. Like, mm-hmm. I just have to be there to get it.
Mm-hmm. Even Yoko Ono referred to the muse when talking about how it seemed like the Beatles were possessed when they were writing music together. So we understand the muse as this bodiless force of inspiration. But it's not just this esoteric force. It's any idea, person, place, or thing that might invoke inspiration. This brings us to the sense that many people know the muse, the artist's muse. Women that artists would look to for inspiration and kind of obsess over and paint many different paintings of them. For example, we have Wally Nizil, who's the muse of Egon Schiele. Victorine Meurent was the muse of Edward Manet. Emile Floge was the muse of Gustav Klimt. And Mary Thries Walter was the muse of Picasso. Thousands of others. These women provided vast inspiration for these artists. And some of their best and most famous works are depictions of these women. Salvador Dali even lost his creativity and passion for art after his muse died. Her name was Gala. Now, obviously, a lot of these women were accomplished artists themselves and deserve recognition. They weren't just muses. But that's for a different video. But for now, we're going to use them as an example of the muse embodied in a person. So the muse can be bodiless or embodied in a person. What about locations? Many recorded instances of artists looking to the landscape for inspiration. And among the innumerable amount of famous and recognizable landscape paintings, many of them depict places that have been found. Salvador Dali was heavily inspired by coastal Spain, and you can see the similarities between the protruding rocks and the arid landscapes in his paintings. And these landscapes are clearly reflected in his work. Many of Van Gogh's paintings can be dotted around France and the Netherlands. The Group of Seven literally only painted Canadian wilderness. So, you could say the entirety of my sweet, sweet country is a muse, including a bunch of paintings in my home city. And these among many artists who look to the landscape for inspiration. I mean, that's where you start. You look to nature, you look to God's natural beauty for inspiration as an artist. A single object could be a muse for an artist. I mean, we could take Monet's water lilies, for example. A bunch of paintings of water lilies and just the repetition. He painted these for years. Is that not considered a muse? Or Via Clemens spent years on multiple paintings of the night sky that were layered up so you could see the depth in between the different marks of paint and would give depth to the painting, but literally just small square paintings of the night sky. Even if an artist doesn't show clear repetition in their work, it's still more than likely they look to a person or a place or a thing or a scenario or an idea for inspiration. Look at Leon Golub and his paintings of violent scenes and weaponry and male anatomy. Philip Guston painted the cartoony KKK cloak figure over and over again in many of his paintings, as well as the bulbous hands and the pointing fingers. Matisse painted stupid shit and he sucks. There's so many possibilities and there's so many fountainheads of inspiration. This leaves the begging question, how does one invoke the muse? Step one, you have to believe in the muse. This sounds a little esoteric, but it's important to believe this force exists. All these artists have felt the muse, so you can take it as proof that something of this sort exists. Secondly, you have to look. It's important to search around and break things up. Find out what inspires you and keep a journal of it in case you notice any patterns, and you can find clues on where to look next time. Inspiration isn't just going to show up on your doorstep, and although the muse, as we've discovered, is a mysterious force, effort still must be put in to find it. Finally, and perhaps the most important step, one has to honor the gifts the muse has given them. Use the inspiration to create something amazing. If you come across a weird rock and feel compelled to fucking draw it 400 times, then do it. That's a gift from the muse. If you only sculpt the same tree for the next 3 years, so be it. These are the gifts the muse has given you. This inspiration is as good as any. And if you ignore this vast inspiration, it's unlikely to strike again. You have to follow this. We don't really grasp what is happening when these forces overtake someone. It could be similar to that of peak experiences or the sublime, but that doesn't matter. It could be a holy force, and either way, the outcome is the same: the drive to chase beauty. God bless.